You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. I'm Professor Gus Martin. And today we're going to investigate another typology of terrorism, ideological terrorism. If you have any questions during this particular presentation, please feel free to call 310-928-7330 or send an email to the address on your screen, and we will answer your questions during this presentation. If you have questions after the conclusion of this presentation, please contact me directly and I will answer your questions as soon as I can. So, let us begin with discussing ideological terrorism. The first thing to remember about this is that ideology has been a source of political violence for more than a century, for several centuries actually. And if you look at your screen, you will see a presentation, a representation of the classical ideological continuum. This is the case of the French Revolution. Now, the reason we're looking at this is very important because you'll notice it has left, center, and right on the screen. These concepts of left wing and right wing come from the French Revolution because during the French Revolution, In its constituent assemblies, and you can see the different assemblies here, the National Constituent Assembly, Legislative Assembly, National Convention, the most radical of the revolutionaries sat on the far left side of the body, of the governing body. Those who were opposed to radical change or revolutionary change sat on the right side of the constituent body. And people who were more balanced in their beliefs were sat in the center. You can see moderates, plain, marsh. You know, the titles changed, but the bottom line is this, that this is where our modern day conceptions of left wing and right wing come from, which I'm sure you've heard many times in our own political culture. So let us explore the classical ideological continuum by moving from the fringe left to the right-wing fringe, beginning with the fringe left. You can see we have here fringe left, far left, liberalism, moderate center. So for the fringe left, this is an extreme and often violent interpretation of Marxist or other leftist ideologies, as you will see, including anarchism and others. They do become violent rather frequently. The far left is a radical interpretation of Marxist or other leftist ideologies, but they are usually nonviolent. So we can certainly call them the extreme left or far left, but they tend to be not violent. They tend to use words rather than bombs. In modern day parlance, the ballot rather than the bullet. Liberalism is a policy agenda promoting people's rights. There's an expectation of positive government role. Now, this is largely an American approach to liberalism, but it has some international currency in the sense that people's rights or cooperation is what is at the essence of liberalism. And then the moderate center is usually the largest center in democracies, segment in democracies, and hopefully this will balance off the far left and the far right. Now, moving farther to the right wing, we see conservatism. Just as with liberalism, this is it's still part of the mainstream. So the conservatism, moderate center, and liberalism are all mainstream. For conservatism in the United States especially, it's a traditional distrust of change or government intervention. All you have to do is simply look at the word, conservatism. There's an attempt to conserve what is in existence at the time. And then for the far right wing, there's strong adherence to social order and tradition. Again, just like in the far left, It certainly is extreme. This is the right-wing extreme, but they tend to not be violent. They are only speaking loudly, if you will, and they're confrontational, but not necessarily violent. The fringe right, though, is uncompromising, often violent, and there's a belief in an ethno-nationalist or religious superiority. Especially in the United States, what we see is this sense of, in the modern era, white nationalism or a link with religious extremism, usually Christian extremism. So we'll explore all of this today, but also when we come back to discussing the American case in about the 12th week or so of the semester. So, with the classical ideological continuum, we see that there are modern political environments for which this is quite relevant. We see that the championed groups are pretty much the same as they have always been, but in the modern era, for example, moving from the fringe left to the fringe right, the fringe left champions classes or nationalities. Their methodology is a so-called liberation movement, and they want radical change. Compare that to the fringe right, where race, ethnicity, nationality, religion, these are the championed groups. And they tend to be an order movement. That'll become clearer in a moment. And they seek reactionary change, usually trying to restore their own supremacy on the fringe right wing. And then everything else in between. But once again, from liberalism to the moderate center to conservatism, this is all mainstream. And ideally, a democracy will have most of its people in the center rather than on the left fringe or the right fringe. Now, let us consider a comparison of ideologies and ideals, beginning with a very basic conceptualization, and that is that an ideology is a system of belief. It is not my opinion. It is not your opinion. It is a system of belief. It usually has a large number of followers who approach these ideological systems of belief much in the same way that some people might approach religion. That is, that there is a single truth. And in this particular case, or this particular typology, that single truth is a political truth. And we will go through some of these political truths. Just understand that the people who are extremists within these ideological belief systems are not attempting to score debating points. They are right. Those who disagree with them are wrong. Either you are with them or you are against them. So this is a form of extremism, as we have discussed before, but it is a political ideological form of extremism. There is always an element of politics with ideologies, but the politics are mixed in with something else. And the something else is, for example, political economics, political racial supremacy, political religious supremacy. So when we talk about an ideology, it is certainly a political environment or political approach, but it has another element also. So we will summarize several basic ideological concepts that are relevant to this course. And let me just say that this is all very complex in its own way, but we will break it down and just so that you know the constituent elements of various ideologies. Beginning with anarchism. We've all heard the word anarchy. We tend to use the word anarchy as if it means chaos. That is far from the truth. Chaos is chaos. Anarchy, anarchism, is a well-thought-out system. It is a well-thought-out ideology. It is purely ideological, though. It believes in minimal central government control. It believes in propaganda by the deed. In other words, anarchism believes in free associations of people without interference from the government or the interference of a political party. And they do not simply believe in spreading the word through publications or television or the internet. They believe in propaganda by the deed. That means actually doing something. Propaganda by the deed. Now, as I said, anarchism is a purely ideological movement. It began in the 19th century in Tsarist Russia, for the most part. So let me explain what I mean by many ideological true believers having this sense that they are right and everyone else is wrong. This quotation is from Sergei Nechayev, from his publication, The Catechism of the Revolutionist. So just think about that, the catechism, which is a religious term, of the revolutionist. A revolutionary abhors any doctrine and refuses any peaceful pursuits, leaving them for future generations. There must exist only one consolation, reward, and pleasure, the triumph of the revolution. Anarchism is similar to nihilism in the sense that nihilism believes in destruction of society and that what comes next is better than what existed before. We are going to see a video right now which looks at what is anarchism. But before we look at it, understand that the anarchist believes in the destruction of the existing order, the creation of free associations of free people who collaborate, who cooperate, but that will exist in a future generation, not in the present generation. There has never been a sustained anarchist society. It has not happened yet. Unlike with Marxism, there have been nations, the Soviet Union, that have existed. But when it comes to anarchism, the actual implementation of anarchism has been fleeting. So let us go to the video now, which we will look at what is anarchy.
Anarchy, the heart of the punk movement in the 70s and 80s, a driving force for civil wars and violent revolutions, a concept held in esteem by activists like Leo Tolstoy, Noam Chomsky, and Mahatma Gandhi. So, what is it? Anarchy, very simply, is a state of being without any government or authority. The original concept of anarchy was born alongside and in response to the concepts of democracy and other political systems. But it wasn't until later, around the 18th and 19th centuries, that modern anarchist philosophy was fully developed in Western countries. Following the French Revolution, anarchism gained prominence as a political alternative to theocracies or monarchies, and as an attempt to achieve total equality by eliminating authoritarian roles. However, as Noam Chomsky and other academics have admitted, it is somewhat of an unrealistic utopian theory. Many forms of modern anarchy are political ideologies that hold the government responsible for the world's problems. Because there are many forms of state control, there are many different forms of anarchy. For example, anarcho-feminism says that hierarchies of the state lead to patriarchy, which leads to oppression. Green anarchism states that environmental exploitation is a result of capitalist government policy. And despite the violence commonly associated with anarchy, anarcho-pacifism holds that it is the state that creates unnecessary political violence and should therefore be abolished. In fact, violence is not an intrinsic part of modern anarchism, as many believe. Tolstoy and Gandhi specifically petitioned against all forms of violence, and Chomsky has said that, quote, anarchy is not people running around the streets breaking store windows, it's a conception of a very organized society with as little control as is feasible. While violence is still controversially used by some groups of anarchists in order to destroy systems of government, many anarchists renounce it. A lot of people would agree that anarchism is a good idea in theory because it promotes both freedom and egalitarianism. However, in practice, it would be difficult to perfect. As Chomsky explains, anarchy is a response to oppressive political movements rather than as a standalone system of government. Democracy is another theory that is often more hard to understand than you might think. To learn more about what democracy really looks like,
so as you can see, anarchism has roots going back several generations. But again, there have been anarchist movements, but no true implementation of a sustained anarchist society. We shall see. Again, Anarchism is still very much with us, with modern neo-anarchists who exist in Western societies and elsewhere. So let us look at our next ideological ideal, and that is Marxism. The first thing to understand about Marxism is that it is believes in class conflict, that is economic conflict. It believes in class warfare leading to a communist dictatorship of the proletariat. The concept is that the working people of the world will engage in revolution. So this is working class revolution. It is opposed to capitalist tendencies such as imperialism, which was certainly present in many Western capitalist empires and others well into the 20th century. Imperialism, of course, is empire building, the exploitation of other countries for the benefit of the center. And then they're also opposed to the concept of so-called neo-colonialism. Neo-colonialism is not the actual occupation and exploitation of another region, but rather the economic exploitation of another region. So from the Marxist perspective, the exploitation of labor in the developing world for the benefit of the prosperous Western world is a form of working class conflict that must be resolved. We're going to see a video in a moment that explicates this a bit more, but understand that the application of Marxism in the modern world has not had a very peaceful historical kind of application. So we'll come back to that in a moment, but before we do that, let us look at Marxism, just an explanation of what it is in a very short video, but it does explain the fundamentals of what Marxism is attempting to do. And so what we see is a very idealistic ideology of Marxism. So the original Marxist revolutionaries were idealists. But the outcome of actual Marxism led to a great deal of hardship for the people within those societies. Basically, the application of communism in the modern era led to official state repression in societies such as the Soviet Union, North Korea, Vietnam, China, Cuba, etc. It also was used as a justification for the so-called wars of national liberation, the anti-colonial wars that were being fought to drive out European powers. It was also used for the so-called liberation identification movements, meaning movements in the democratic West that identified with, from their perspective, the struggles of the developing world. So we'll come back to this again and again, and always remember that Marxism is not like nihilism. There is a very well thought out objective for Marxist revolutionaries in comparison to nihilists and even anarchists. So Marxism has a model for how the post-revolutionary society will exist. Which brings us to fascism, the next ideology and ideal of the modern era. Fascism believes in a strong anti-democratic, anti-communist belief in law and order. It is often ethnocentric or even racist and militaristic. It peaked in the 1940s, that is, international fascism peaked in the 1940s, but the concepts, again, are state-controlled political expression, extreme law and order. It's anti-communist, anti-intellectual, and it believes in the preservation of old values, going back into history in order to restore the glory of the favored group. So they might use religion, such as the church. They would uphold women, but only from the perspective of motherhood. Absolute loyalty to the state is expected, and there is a great deal of cultural conservatism to the extreme. There's a belief in a strong centralized leadership. It could be a strong civilian model or a strong militaristic model. And always there is a strong security apparatus. During the Second World War, which was the true birth of fascism, we saw fascist regimes rise in Europe and arguably Japan, although they did not call themselves fascists. But we saw it in Spain, Italy, Germany, Romania, Hungary, and elsewhere. And the Second World War was initiated. It was sparked. It was lit by fascist nations. After the war, we saw a number of fascist-like regimes or governments that arose in places like Greece, Argentina, Chile, and elsewhere. So let us now look at a video, a short video, that discusses what is fascism. Because this word is thrown around far too much, and it is used very incorrectly. When people attempt to label someone as a fascist, they're often very incorrect in what they're saying. So let us look at this video and then discuss these ideologies further.
As far as political ideologies go, none is more universally reviled than fascism. Although the movement was only in effect for a short while in a select few countries, its repercussions are still felt to this day. So what exactly is fascism? Essentially, fascism was born out of the idea that rational egalitarian democracies would ultimately lead to severe crisis and weakness. Around the late 1800s, a more irrational and emotional structure based on social Darwinism began to overtake the idea that people should have equality. Instead, fascism promised to create the rebirth of a new, stronger, and greater society stripped of all its weaknesses. Some point to Italian writer and poet Gabriele D'Annunzio as the originator of this ideology. During the 1930s and 40s, it saw significant influence, first in Italy, then in Germany, and finally Japan, although a large number of countries borrowed the ideology around the same time. In effect, fascism operates under a strict doctrine. First off, it attempts to unify countries under a single genetic banner. Often, this nationalism includes the concept of racial or cultural purity as a method of weeding out weakness. Hitler used this to paint Jews and other groups as not being part of a pure Aryan race, and thus worthy of being eliminated. Second is the total control of society and people by the state, called totalitarianism. Citizens are expected to have unwavering faith in a single party ruling elite, in nearly all cases, a dictator. It is intended to directly oppose pluralism, which is the ability of multiple parties to compete for power. Economically, fascism seeks to solve the problems of materialist capitalism and Marxist socialism. In practice, countries did this by promoting private enterprise and handsomely rewarding successful businessmen while abolishing unions. However, the state would only allow businesses which served and promoted the national interest. They also sought to ban foreign trade to avoid becoming dependent on any other country. The end goal is to become fully self-sufficient and to be able to allocate significant resources towards the military. Fascism is also intensely supportive of violence to achieve political means. That specifically includes removing weak people from the fascist state, either by executing or deporting them, all through strict social laws enforced by a violent police army. In the 30s, these were Hitler's brown shirts and Mussolini's black shirts. Finally, as a social ideology, fascism promotes youth and revolution, with a particular focus on strengthening desirable and supposedly moral characteristics. For example, in fascist Italy, homosexuality was seen as moral weakness and expressly forbidden, along with pornography and prostitution. In Nazi Germany, abortions were legal and often compulsory in states of deformity or non-Aryan racial characteristics. However, for healthy Aryan babies, abortion was illegal. Fascism is intended to craft a society to the ultimate ambitions of a single ruling party. As history has shown, this has promoted mass murder, eugenics, censorship, propaganda, and severe inequality. Some have said that fascism defies the political spectrum entirely and is neither left nor right. In the end, fascism is exactly what it sounds like, a complete nightmare. Want to learn
political theory? So fascism, as it has been applied historically, is not attempting to, whitewash what they are trying to do. They have overtly engaged in repression of freedom of thought, in intellectualism, the manipulation of religion, the extermination of undesirable groups. It goes on and on. So fascists are very honest in their own way about what they are attempting to do, attempting to create the perfect society for the selected people, whether that is a selected ethnic group, racial group, or religious group. So fascism has some appeal among those who believe that they are part of some sort of select or superior, morally superior, racially superior group. So let us conclude our comparison of ideologies by just looking at this table. Remember that anarchism, Marxism, fascism, and then we had discussed the just war previously, are specific orientations. Proponents include the founders of these ideas or prominent leaders. And then the desired social outcome, stateless society for anarchism, dictatorship of the proletariat for Marxism, a new order for fascism. Remember that the just war conflict attempted to explain when conflict is justifiable. And then there were many applications, and these are just representative of the different applications of these particular ideological orientations. So this concludes our comparison of ideologies. And let us now begin looking at left-wing ideologies and activism. Now, I want to first say that we will spend more time discussing the left because there's more to it. It is more complex than the right wing, especially the extremist right wing. But there are certain common characteristics. Firstly, there is an emphasis on economic rights. Now, let me explain this. Economic rights refer to the right to certain economic benefits. For example, there's a difference between economic rights and political rights. In the United States, we tend to uphold political rights over economic rights. But it might include guaranteed health care, for example, or guaranteed retirement benefits, a livable minimum wage. And in other words, the kinds of rights that you find in European countries and others. Now, democratic socialism, as you can see, compared to communism, is very different. Many people in the United States will lump together democratic socialism and communism, but they are different ideological approaches, both of which believe in economic rights, but democratic socialism believes in or upholds reformism. It is group-oriented, it believes in the collective, but here, socialism and democracy are completely compatible. They emphasize reform rather than religion, bargaining, the ballot box. They can be radical, but some democratic socialists are rather conservative in their own way. There are democratic socialist and communist parties in Europe. Democratic socialist parties in Europe are very mainstreamed. Europeans think nothing of describing themselves as a socialist, unlike in the United States, where it's still a very hot political issue. Communists believe in revolution. As we've said, they emphasize revolution within a certain program. They are not nihilistic. They offer a vision for the future. If you want to find a good anti-communist, look for a democratic socialist, because communists believe that it is inevitable that the working class will engage in violent revolution. Democratic socialists do not believe that whatsoever. Communism believes in from each according to their ability, to each according to their needs. So think about that. From each according to their ability, to each according to their needs. Which means, very simply, for example, a surgeon, a physician who is unmarried will receive what they need from the state economically. They'll receive, for example, a one-bedroom apartment and enough food for one person. A barista who has five children will receive more from the state. They'll receive, arguably, a four- or five-bedroom apartment and enough food for five people. So from each according to their ability, to each according to their needs. In the United States, of course, in a capitalist society, the comparison would be the greatest good for the greatest number, meaning there will be the greatest good for most people, but not everyone will make it. And that is acceptable in capitalism. In an idealistic communist society, that's unacceptable. But remember that the application of communism has been essentially political repression. Now, let us look at two websites to illustrate this. Firstly, the Socialist International. This is a mainstream socialist assembly. It's an assembly of socialist parties from Latin America, well, from the world. I was going to say Latin America, the Caribbean, Europe, but it's from everywhere in the world. And these are democratic socialists. Again, they believe in the compatibility of democracy and socialism. There are democratic socialist political parties in probably most countries in the world. They are certainly not a political party in the United States, but there is a movement in the United States. During recent presidential campaigns, Bernie Sanders, the senator from Vermont, has demonstrated this. Now, compare that to this website from the United Kingdom dedicated to communism. This is, as you can see, it's called In Defense of Marxism, and this is a Marxist, a communist analysis of events in the world. And they report the struggle, if you will. And they still have a great deal of literature on this website. And they look at a history to explain why communism or Marxism should be defended, even in the modern era where the true communist nations really are rather marginal. So, understand that Marxism and socialism have their adherents, and you can find this on the internet. Now, one thing to remember about Orthodox Marxism is this concept of class struggle. Class struggle refers to what Karl Marx and other true communists believe is a scientific law. It is a law of class conflict. It is a conflict theory. Basically, one's political power and one's definition within society is defined by their relationship to the means of production. So understand, the means of production refers to factories, refers to corporations or companies. If we are workers within those factories and companies, then we are members of the proletariat. The ultimate goal of Marxism is to, after the revolution, establish the dictatorship of the proletariat. So let us look at this class pyramid that very simplistically explains the lens of the world, the vision of the world among Marxists in the industrial age. So this is the industrial age class pyramid. You can see that at the top is the owners. These are the ruling class, and they own the means of production. Beneath them in the pyramid is the bourgeoisie. I'm sure that most of you have heard this word of bourgeoisie. Well, it's French for middle class. These are the managers in the corporations, the managers in the factories. Those who went to college to become managers end up members of the bourgeoisie. So their relationship to the means of production is to manage the means of production for the ruling class. The proletariat are the workers. They are industrial workers or office workers. They're the wage earners. They're the wage earners who support the wealth of the ruling class and the position of the bourgeoisie who have been bought off by the ruling class. And then you'll notice a small group at the bottom, which Karl Marx referred to as the lumpenproletariat. These are people who do not work. They do not produce for society. Therefore, they are lumped in at the bottom of the pyramid. And Karl Marx and communists, that is, orthodox communists, have no use for them. These are people who refuse to work or, for example, are the homeless who we see in our society. They have no place after the revolution in society. So we are going to look at a video which will explain this class pyramid. It will internationalize, it will globalize this concept of the class pyramid because, arguably, there is a global dimension that does exist for this class pyramid. And the question, of course, always is, what do we do about it? Well, the solution among Marxists is revolution. But let us go to this video to explain the globalization of the class pyramid.
These are all from different campaigns to make this stuff concrete as possible. We purchase all of the products from the factories that we're talking about. This shirt sells for $14.99, and the women who made the shirt got paid 3 cents. Liz Claiborne jackets made in El Salvador. The jackets are $178, and the workers were paid 74 cents for every jacket they made. Alpine cost aerials, 31 cents an hour. It's not just sneakers, it's not just apparel, it's everything. We were in Honduras, and some workers, they knew the kind of work that we did, and they approached us, these young workers, and they said, conditions in our factory are horrible. Will you please meet with us? And we said we would, but you can't meet in the developing world. You can't walk up to a factory with your notebook and workers come out, interview them. I mean, there's goons, there's spies, the military police. So you do everything in a clandestine manner. We're about to start the meeting, and in walk three guys, very tough looking guys. The company had found out about a meeting and sent these spies. Obviously, we didn't have the meeting, but these young girls were really bright. And as they were leaving, away from the eyesight of the spies, they started to put their hands underneath the table. And I put my palm under there, put my hand under there, and they put into my hand their pay stubs. So we'd know who they were, what they were paid, and the labels that they made in the factory, so we'd know who they worked for. And I took my hand out after everyone had left, and in the palm of my hand was the face of Kathy Lee Gifford. But the bottom of it is the interesting part. A portion of the proceeds from the sale of this garment will be donated to various children's charities. It's very touching. Get your right here. Walmart is telling you if you purchase these pants, and Kathy Lee is telling you purchase these pants, you're going to help children. The problem was the people who handed us the label were 13 years of age.
Do many people in her family work?
Just me.
You support. How many people do you support?
Eight people.
And how do you do with that salary? Is it enough?
Alcanza, es suficiente.
This is a private company.
Yes.
Without permission, how can you come here?
Well, the door was wide open, and
door is wide open. You told the employees, not for you.
We went through the garbage dump in the Dominican Republic. We always do this kind of stuff. We dig around. One day, we found a big pile of Nike's internal pricing documents. Nike assigns a time frame to each operation. They don't talk about minutes. They break the time frame into 10,000ths of a second. You get to the bottom of all 22 operations to give the workers 6.6 minutes to make the shirt. It's 70 cents an hour in the Dominican Republic. That 6.6 minutes equals 8 cents. These are Nike's documents. That means the wages come to 0.3% of the retail price. This is the reality. It's the science of exploitation.
So what we see is, from the Marxist point of view, how the class pyramid that we just observed, that we just went through, has become globalized. Understand that that analysis is something that is accepted in many political movements. It is not clearly not accepted in the West necessarily, but it is accepted in many areas of the developing world. Now, continuing our look at the left-wing ideologies and ideals, we need to understand this concept of leftist nationalism. This is a selective application of Marxist theory that is rooted in Cold War rivalries. In other words, during many of these anti-colonial wars and many of the rebellions that occurred, Marxism became, because it is a conflict theory, it became an ideological foundation for many of these movements. As you can see from this photograph, these are women soldiers in Cuba, in Havana, Cuba. And the Cuban Revolution arguably was a Marxist nationalist revolution. So we see that many of these wars of national liberation adopted Marxist ideology during the wars. And one form of extremism on the left that we have to understand is this idea of special interest extremism, the single issue terrorism, single issue violence. One example is environmentalism, extremists, and the other is the peace movement. And ironically, members of the peace movement have been known to be violent. And as you can see by this photograph, these are two individuals holding puppies, which is fine, but they are members of the Animal Liberation Front, and they are anarchists, and that is why they're wearing masks. So this particular anarchist movement, the Animal Liberation Front, has engaged in mostly economic vandalism. So let me show you a website dedicated to this particular movement for the Animal Liberation Front. This is a website maintained by the Animal Liberation Front. It is as they say, a press office, but it is dedicated to events around the world involving environmental liberation. And you can see it involves a great deal of, property destruction, but also the so-called liberation of animals and the destruction of laboratories and others. So the ALF, the Animal Liberation Front, is an anarchist collective, if you will, that is very much globalized, especially in the West. They're in the United States and in Europe for the most part. And we can see the reports from around the world. I should mention, when you look at the warnings and glued doors shut at restaurants, many of them are vegans and are opposed to the use of animal products. Anyway, the bottom line is this, that when we look at single issues on the far left, they can be quite active, actually. And just to conclude this review of the far left, the ideologies and ideals, understand that the radical left does not get along with itself. There are factions always arising on the radical left, and there tends to be a real problem with how to pursue the left-wing revolution. Marx assumed that the revolutions would occur in the developed world, meaning in England and Germany. He dismissed any attempts to mobilize rural peasants or the lumpen proletariat. But Marxist revolutions occurred in the developing world, which raised serious problems. Infighting about the Revolutionary Party or Soviet communism versus developing world communism. The working classes in the West never acquired a revolutionary consciousness. So what we see is this, that the revolutions occurred in Russia, first one, which was pre-industrial. We also saw successful Marxist rebellions in Vietnam, Cuba, Nicaragua, and non-Marxist rebellions in Mexico and Algeria and elsewhere. So the actual predictions that Karl Marx promoted did not occur as he thought they would. They created, that is, in order to address this, Marxist revolutionaries created a concept that we need to keep in mind as we continue for the rest of the semester. That is the idea, the concept of a vanguard party or vanguard movement. Now, within these particular movements, there were required readings that on the New Left, for example. We saw that in order to promote the redefined concept of Marxist revolution, Frantz Fanon, who we've talked about before, wrote The Wretched of the Earth, and here he described rebellion in the developing world, liberating violence, which we have already discussed, actually. Then Herbert Marcuse was a German philosopher. He was an existentialist philosopher. He believed that capitalist society created manacles of privilege, chains of privilege on the middle class. So that these manacles keep the public docile and content. People's oppression is measured by how much they have been bought off by capitalist comfort. So what happened was middle-class revolutionaries, that is, middle-class students who rejected these manacles, rejected these chains of capitalism, they became proletarianized. Proletarianized. So these are middle-class members of the elite who decided that they would identify with the oppressed of the world, and they became proletarianized in their minds. They rejected the manacles of privilege, and they began to engage in rebellion in their own ways. Many of the terrorist groups that came from the left really were inspired or influenced by this concept that Herbert Marcuse promoted and others promoted, but that he promoted in the book One Dimensional Man. And, very importantly, Carlos Marighella, who wrote the mini manual of the urban guerrilla. It was very influential and still is rather influential. It is a blueprint for revolution in urban societies. Not necessarily working class revolution, but a blueprint for any revolution in urban societies. His mini manual of the urban guerrilla was written in order to foment rebellion in Latin America originally. Carlos Marighella was a Brazilian communist. But this particular book, this mini manual, is still influencing those who would like to engage in urban rebellion. And it did influence many revolutionary movements in Latin America, in Europe, and in the United States. So Carlos Marighella provided guidelines for using urban terrorism to create revolutionary conditions. Yes, he was a communist, but he believed in terrorism in order to provoke governments to overreact. We've mentioned this concept before. It is enraging the beast. He believed that through terrorist violence, the government would overreact, and that would cause the people to rise up in a rebellion against that particular government. Let us investigate now vanguard theory, and then we will take a short break. So, vanguard theory. Know this concept. Remember this concept because it certainly applies when we talk about left-wing rebellion, but it applies when we talk about many insurgent movements, including Al-Qaeda, including Islamic State. So understand this concept of vanguard theory. This concept was developed and designed by, first, in the Russian Revolution. It believes that an educated elite leads the revolution. What happened was the Russian communists, led by Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, saw that the working class was not rising up the way Marx had predicted. So he formed a party, the Communist Party, the Bolsheviks, as they referred to them themselves. I mean, a Bolshevik means majoritarian. So this Communist Party is not like the parties in a democracy. It is a combat party. It is a war-fighting party. And it was made up of members of the elite. This elite was intended to lead the working classes to revolution. A similar theory was designed by Che Guevara, who many people know about because he fought in the Cuban Revolution and then became independent and fought elsewhere in Latin America, and also in Africa he appeared. Che Guevara developed a theory known as Foquismo. He believed in the fire of revolution, sparking a revolution. It's also known as Foco theory, but Che Guevara did not believe in consolidating a Marxist revolution in one country, such as the Soviet Union or in Cuba. He believed in sparking a revolutionary fire throughout South America, throughout Latin America, actually, including Central America. He believed that an international climate of revolution could be created in Latin America, and this was the focus of the revolution. You just needed a revolutionary push by a vanguard, a revolutionary spark. He emphasized an immediate impact rather than long-term consciousness building among the poor, the working class, or the peasants. So in 1967, he and his followers went to Bolivia to begin this spark, to implement Foquismo, and he failed. He and his followers were annihilated by the Bolivian army, but he is still popular. This concept of the vanguard theory of Foquismo has been adapted. It has evolved into the modern era, this idea that an educated elite can lead the masses to revolution is very much with us, not only on the left wing, but on the right wing, and I mentioned among some of the Islamists, like Al-Qaeda. So, let us take a break now, a short break, and then we'll come back to exploring a few case studies of the terrorist left, just so that you can understand how the terrorist left implemented these theories that we have talked about. So we'll go to the break now.
You're watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Yo, I feel like before I was just by myself. I'm not gonna get distracted by anything or anybody. I'm just here on a mission, that's what I thought. But I started to realize that I didn't want to be just a student. I want to be like a motivation to somebody.
I love my job. I wanted to be able to have a place, like a laboratory on campus, that people could actually get hands-on into making a difference. The CSUDH Urban Farm is one part of the operation that we're building here. We have energy systems, we have food systems, we have transportation systems, and we're trying to make them more sustainable.
I started to volunteer a lot to just let myself get exposed to different things that I wasn't used to get out of that comfort zone.
One of the reasons I teach here is because my own artwork has a really strong tie to the LA community. There's some really amazing artists who live and work in South Los Angeles. They want to work with our students. And when they actually meet these artists, it's like very transformative. They start to realize that their time here at CSUDH isn't about finding something new to make art about. It's actually about how to shape and engage the community with the things that are already important to them.
I want to become an orthopedic surgeon, and right now I have an internship at Kaiser, and that's one of the things I want to do in the outside world, is just to help the community. I'm not only changing my life, you know, but I'm also changing other people's lives.
That is that thing of like, I want to get up and work hard to change things for the future, to make things better. I want to interact with my community. How does this small system that we're building out here relate to the larger regional system? Because ultimately that has to happen for the entire city, the entire country, the entire world.
My name is Devin.
My name is Johnny.
My name is Jenny, and I'm a Toro.
Thank you. am a first-generation student, and I never really thought that what I was doing was important. Without the help of everybody that's mentored me so far, I don't feel like I would have gotten as far as I have.
For me, that's the best thing about being here. Seeing them achieve things that they never thought they could.
It was a long road to get my bachelor's degree. I took a very untraditional path. I was working, supporting myself. I didn't know what I didn't know. And I made it a point to introduce myself to all of my professors while I was here.
Somebody who's already at this place where you want to be is recognizing something within you. And it gives you the permission to believe in yourself.
Our research focuses on the intersection between psychology, technology, and media, how people's media consumption can affect them. I think it's remarkable that CSUDH has been represented on 60 Minutes, on national media. To me, that points to the amazing cutting-edge research that we're doing.
If it wasn't for professors like Dr. Shabir, who had honestly bigger dreams for me than I have for myself, I wouldn't have had one of the most rewarding experiences, not only at CSUDH, but also in my life. The year after I graduated, I got recruited to Facebook, and I thought nobody's ever gonna ask me about the degree. That was the first question they asked.
Ideas can really blossom here. For instance, joining a lab, or having an idea for some program that you want to start. We really allow those kinds of ideas to grow.
The feeling I had when I was here as a student was that I could do anything. How can I share that experience that I had here with all the other students now?
Mentorship in that sense is incredibly important because I started to believe in my own ability, and that definitely helped me, I suppose, become the person that I really am. For me, success is reaching the point where I can become help to other people. And now I'm heading off to my PhD.
My name is Brie.
My name is Nancy.
My name is Amarantha, and I'm a Toro.
With people who share the same goals as you. If you believe it, you can do it.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, welcome back to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. Let us continue our discussion by looking at case studies from Europe and Latin America in order to illustrate the concepts that we have just discussed, beginning with this regional case in Latin America. And if you will look at this photograph, you will notice that this is an insurgency with men and women standing side by side. This is from Colombia. This is the FARC communist. It was a Marxist insurgency that lasted for about 50 years. One thing that's interesting about these insurgencies that are nationalist or that are ideological, meaning Marxist, is that men and women fight side by side during the war in the field. So let us look at this case study by discussing, first of all, Colombia. I just want to mention Colombia because they had a 50-year insurgency led by FARC and also the National Liberation Army. FARC was founded in 1964 and at its peak had about 17,000 fighters. There was a peace agreement that was signed in November of 2016, but they waged a fairly intensive guerrilla war using terrorist tactics frequently. So it was not strictly a terrorist organization, but they certainly used terrorism during this war. They engaged in kidnappings, assassinations, robberies, and also the use of child soldiers, which we have discussed previously. Then in Peru, Shining Path, Sendero Luminoso. Sendero Luminoso was actually a Marxist-like terrorist movement that actually was not necessarily strictly orthodox Marxist. It was founded by a professor, a philosophy professor named Abimael Guzman, who essentially led his students into the countryside to wage a terrorist campaign. They were fairly intensive during the 1980s and 1990s. Their war cost 30,000 lives. What's very interesting about them is they participated in the cocaine trade, the coca trade. They went into the fields where the coca farmers were growing coca, and they declared that they had liberated them. They used the proceeds from the coca trade to fund the revolution. FARC in Colombia did exactly the same thing. They used the cocaine trade to fund the revolution. So understand that there is this nexus between revolution and illicit trafficking that we will come back to when we discuss criminal dissident terrorism. And then in Argentina, we saw the rise of the Montoneros, who were young urban terrorists. They mixed together certainly Marxist principles, but they also, their ideology incorporated leftist nationalism, Roman Catholic principles of justice, and a form of Argentinian Peronist kinds of nationalism. They were fairly effective. They championed justice for all. They attracted a lot of followers. They were skillful kidnappers and probably raised about $60 million in kidnapping bounties. They engaged in shootings, bombings, and assassinations, mostly in the capital city of Buenos Aires, but also elsewhere. They did try to do what Carlos Mirighella encouraged urban terrorists to do, and that is provoke the beast, to enrage the beast. And they did. The Argentine military seized power in March of 1976 and formed what can only be described as a fascist government. The fascist government annihilated the Montoneros. But during this war, the so-called dirty war in Argentina, the military junta disappeared thousands of Argentines. In other words, these bodies have never been found. They would throw them into the ocean from helicopters, and there's speculation that they buried them in construction sites, which is, buildings which may have been being built, where actually they have bodies underneath. So the bottom line is this, that during these this particular terrorist campaign, they succeeded in enraging the beast, but they were defeated. And then another regional case, just would like to mention, is Europe. You see here on the screen identical tactics that were used by the Red Brigade in Italy and the Red Army faction in Germany. They kidnapped prominent people. In the example of the Red Brigade, it was Aldo Moro, who's a former prime minister, and then Hans Martin Schleyer in the case of the Red Army faction. Both were executed. Both were killed or murdered by the terrorists. So firstly, the Red Brigade in Italy, they were similar to the Montaneros and some other groups. They began with the radicalized student movement. The Red Brigade engaged in, from 1969 to 1979, 15,000 terrorist attacks in Italy. They almost brought down the Italian democracy. Their signature was the kneecapping of victims. In other words, they walk behind someone, put a pistol into the back of their knees, their knee pits, and pull the trigger. These years were called the Years of Lead in Italy. By 1989, though, 2,000 terrorists had been convicted, and the Red Brigade was eventually dismantled through aggressive Italian security work. But they almost succeeded in bringing down the Italian democracy. The German Red Army faction, also known as the Bader-Meinhof group, grew out of the student protest movement in the 1960s. They are interesting because they cooperated with European and Middle Eastern terrorist groups. They are very close to the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. And, interestingly, they were very close to Carlos the Jackal. We've mentioned Ilich Ramirez, also known as Carlos. Carlos was affiliated with the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, but he was also affiliated with the Red Army faction. The Red Army faction eventually went through three phases. Each phase was destroyed by the West German securities environment, but they also collapsed when the Berlin Wall collapsed, which indicates that they received a great deal of assistance from the Soviet bloc, in particular East Germany. So the Red Army faction is interesting because they were multinational or international in their particular sweep, but they were also very much a proxy of the Soviet bloc. And just to summarize terrorism on the left, this particular table looks at the various groups and organizations from Europe and Latin America, and you can see the similarities between all of them. And when we look at this, their targets, their adversaries were the same, their constituencies were also very similar. So let us now leave the left and look at the extreme right wing. One thing to understand is that when we talk about political parties and dissident movements, on the right wing, they tend to not be transnational, although they are beginning to show some transnational aspects. Rather, they reflect the distinctive features of their national environments, so that we see neo-fascist political parties in Europe and Latin America, but not in the United States, and unorganized or partly organized dissident movements. This particular photograph is taken from the United States, but understand that members of the far right wing, the racialist right wing, do tend to encourage each other internationally, but there is not this transnational solidarity, transnational collaboration that we saw on their left wing. First of all, on the extreme right wing, the right wing believes in tradition and order. They have nostalgia for a lost utopia that they believe has been stolen from them, and they have to regain it from the usurpers. That is an enemy group. So they are the defenders of a supreme principle such as a new order. And they scapegoat groups as enemies who have stolen their former glory. So they believe in law and order on a grand scale, on an extreme scale. So the actual elements, if you will, of extreme right-wing environments are, firstly, right-wing nationalism. There's this notion of a superior national group or race, loyalty to the superior group, and they subordinate inferior groups. So there is a great deal of scapegoating of these inferior groups. For example, in Germany, United States, United Kingdom, there are all racialist groups that they are scapegoating. There is religion and mysticism in the United States among these far right-wing groups, but it's not universal, a universal trait on the reactionary right. Again, it's common in the United States, but less common in Europe or Latin America. They will use religion, or perhaps say that they are part of for example, a Christian crusade, but they are simply using it in Europe and Latin America. It's not a fundamental tenet as we see in the United States. And then scapegoating is very common, as I mentioned, possibly a universal trait on the extreme right wing. And here we see scapegoats of the reactionary right. Let me explain this. This is a case study of, these are case studies of the United States, Germany, and the United Kingdom. What we see is that they are very similar, but not exactly the same. So these reflect, as I mentioned before, the distinctive environments of each nation, but they are all scapegoated for the same reasons, that the dominant group, or the formerly dominant group, believes that their glory was stolen by these particular scapegoated groups. So, let me explain something about the terrorist right before we discuss this. The terrorist right, in comparison to the terrorist left, has been less globalized in its solidarity among the various groups that engage in violence. Plus, the movements, the actual terrorist environments, have not been sustained on the extreme right wing in comparison to the extreme left. The terrorist environments for the extreme left have gone on for years, often for decades. We do not see this on the violent right wing, except for one exception, and that is the exception of the paramilitaries, the extreme right-wing paramilitaries that we've seen in Central and South America and elsewhere, who are neo-fascist in their ideologies, and they have been sustained within their particular environments. But aside from the paramilitaries, we have not seen that same phenomenon on the right wing that we saw on the left wing. So let us explore, firstly, the organization of the extreme right wing. They tend to be small groups, not large insurgencies. They are cells, they are organized in cells, meaning individuals or small groups, or they are simply street toughs, for example, racist skinheads. The exception, of course, is the paramilitaries. They are sustained and they are better organized. The focus is indiscriminate violence, meaning that unlike the left, which tends to be more surgical and more discriminating, the violence coming from the right wing tends to lump entire groups of people as being enemies, racial groups, religious groups. So the mass shootings that we have seen in the United States, New Zealand, Europe, and elsewhere from the right wing have tended to be from neo-fascists or others, and they are mass homicides. The longevity is that there are rarely terrorist campaigns, as I mentioned. They tend to be incidents or they are short campaigns, similar to crime sprees rather than campaigns. But the exception, of course, is the paramilitaries. Which brings us to, just very briefly, because as you will see, these particular cases are not as long-term as we saw in the left wing. In Germany, we usually see street-level confrontations, and it tended to be anti-immigrant violence. There have been some shootings that have occurred by lone wolves, but this usually street-level, and it's anti-immigrant, and it is rarely well-organized. In Italy, there are neo-fascist political parties and movements, so those are a foundation for the random attacks by small fascist-leaning groups. Again, there's very little longevity. And in Turkey, what we see is that they reflect extreme nationalism. They are certainly right-wing, they are anti-communist, anti-leftist, but they reflect the particular environment of Turkey, they're trying to reclaim the glory of the old Turkish Empire. So if terrorism on the right, what we see are, in Latin America, death squads, which are the paramilitaries. And these, the listing that you see here do reflect paramilitaries that had some longevity. In the European case, though, very few, if any of these, had longevity, other than the Northern Ireland Ulster Volunteer Force and the Loyalist Ulster Volunteer Force. These were Protestant groups, extreme right wing, that had some longevity. But these are exceptions in comparison to other groups on the right wing. So let us look at two case studies. And let me just mention this before we look at these case studies. We are going to look at two individuals. Remember, as we discussed in previous presentations, there is this phenomenon of the lone wolf terrorist, in which individuals who are not necessarily strongly affiliated with any particular organization engage in mass homicides because they have been radicalized individually. The lone wolf phenomenon exists internationally on the right wing. The lone wolf phenomenon in the United States, of course, is unfortunately rather common. Elsewhere, it's not as common in Western Europe and also in down under in Australia and in New Zealand, but they do occur in the South Pacific. They do occur in Europe and Latin America. So let us look at Anders Breivik firstly. He is a neo-fascist in Norway. Anders Breivik represents the rise of violent neo-fascism and white nationalism internationally. He's a good example. So on July 22nd, 2011, first he detonated a car bomb in Oslo, Norway, using ammonium nitrate and fuel oil. We will come back to this concoction, to this mixture later. Just understand that this is available to create bombs. He killed 8 people in Oslo. He then went to a youth camp on Utøya Island and methodically murdered 77 people. This was a 90-minute attack using a carbine and a handgun. And as you can see, that this occurred on this island, and you can see the sequence of what he did. On the island, it was a day camp for social democrats, democratic socialist youth camp, and he landed and methodically walked through the island shooting teenagers who were part of this social democrat youth group that was essentially vacationing on this island, or at least having a retreat on this island. And he killed 77 people. His motive was neo-fascism, and he is a good example of the concept of neo-fascism, white nationalism, and other ideologies that have become internationalized. So what we see here is in Christchurch, New Zealand, on March 15th, 2019, an individual named Brenton Harrison Tarrant attacked two Muslim places of worship using assault weapons. He killed 50 people and wounded more than 50 others, and he live streamed it on Facebook at the time. So what we see here is a good example, just as we saw with Anders Breivik, of the internationalization of the neo-fascist violence and white nationalism that is occurring in the world. This particular pamphlet, this manifesto, The Great Replacement, reflects this attack by Brenton Harrison Tarrant. And it is a manifesto which was reflects a new ideology called replacement theory. This is the motive of international white nationalism. International white nationalism believes that these migrants and immigrants that are coming into Europe, New Zealand, Australia, and the United States are attempting to replace the dominant group, meaning white Europeans, white Australians, white New Zealanders, and also white Americans. So this is a neo-fascist racial conspiracy theory. So the Great Replacement has actually caught on among adherents of this particular neo-fascist and white nationalist movement. So the commonalities that we see are the target selection, which is essentially, beginning with Muslims and Jews on the religious spectrum, but also people of color who are on the racial or ethno-nationalist spectrum. The motive is to suppress the rights of these religious groups and also these ethno-nationalist or racial groups to try and demonstrate that the old order, the supremacy of the old order, is something that needs to be reestablished from these people of color and these religious groups, Jews and Muslims. The weaponry is very similar. They tend to be military-grade weapons, assault rifles and others. And there is a modern use of social media and the internet to promote these movements. This is the interesting thing, in the sense that on the left wing, we saw manifestos like the Communist Manifesto or Frantz Fanon's books or Herbert Marcuse's. We saw Carlos Marighella's books. What we see now is the use of social media and the internet, the technology to spread the word about neo-fascism and white nationalism. So the use of the internet and social media is a phenomenon that is very prevalent on the extreme right wing and the fringe white right wing. So, just to conclude, what we see is that the new terrorism that we see in the world is very difficult to be classified as right wing or left wing. The religious, the Islamist terrorism is neither right wing nor left wing. It is simply Islamist terrorism. The terrorist left in the new era, what we have seen is a defeat of most insurgencies, both urban guerrillas and the rebels in the hills. Most of these groups have been defeated in the modern era. But there is some grassroots and neo-anarchist activism which could lead to new terrorist incidents. They tend to not occur in the modern era, but some of the neo-anarchists do engage in vandalism during protests and other incidents. It remains to be seen whether the neo-anarchists or other single-issue groups engage in true terrorism on the left. In the right wing, though, we see that there is a resurgence of political violence. There is continued scapegoating, which is a foundation, an ideological foundation for right-wing violence. And there are right-wing reactions to unpopular agendas and also to the new migrant and immigration issues that are occurring. And there is an international right-wing nationalism that is growing, that is being communicated through the internet and also through via social networking media. So the international right-wing nationalism has taken hold, it has taken root, and the conspiracy theories such as replacement theory have also taken root on the extreme right wing. We shall see what the future holds with this particular phenomenon. If you wish to engage in further research and also to research for examinations and others, please go to the open access student resources that are affiliated with your textbook. And if you have any questions between now and our next presentation, please do contact me directly. I'd be glad to talk to you or answer your questions. So, this is Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. For our next presentation, we will explore the typology of international terrorism. I'm Professor Gus Martin, and I'll see you next time. Thank you.